Bling Blong, everyone. Our new podcast miniseries, Talking Mission Hill, is now exclusively on Patreon.
Put on your spicy pants every Friday with a new podcast covering each episode of the cult series from Simpsons legends Bill Oakley and Josh Weinstein.
$5 subscribers at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons can hear every episode, plus all of our previous miniseries about Futurama, King of the Hill, and The Critic.
So don't be a Beardsley. Sign up for Talking Mission Hill today.
I heartily endorse this event or product.
Ahoy, hoy, everybody, and welcome to Talking Simpsons, recorded over the good tarp. I'm your host, Imagination Christmas Celebrator Bob Mackey, and this is our chronological exploration of The Simpsons. Who else is here with me today?
Henry Gilbert, and I'm using my brains this episode. My delicious brains.
And who do we have on the line?
You have Lindsay Katai, and I'm just happy to be here with these boys of mine.
Excellent. Today's episode is Little Big Mom.
Feels like I'm wearing nothing at all. Nothing at all. Nothing at all.
Stupid sexy Flanders.
We have struck gold in the meme mines, and today's episode aired on January 9th, 2000. And as always, Henry will tell us what happened on this mythical day in real world history.
Welcome to the 2000s, Bobby, as this is our first episode of the year 2000, and this is when Dan Marino played his final NFL game. America Online announces an agreement to purchase Time Warner for $162 billion.
What?
And debuting right after this episode, Malcolm in the Middle.
A major success for Fox.
Yeah, one of their biggest live-action successes in comedy, I think, ever.
And it's why they canceled every animated show after it went live.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. They kill all of those shows.
But what I know most about Dan Marino's career, I learned through the documentary Ace Ventura, Pet Detective.
Yes, yeah. Which, a documentary now is hard to go back to.
Yeah, let's not put that on any service.
Problematic documentary.
But the America Online thing is interesting because that is connected to this episode. The voice of America Online is in this episode.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
And that Time Warner merger was a crazy thing. Like, now it's normal to hear of a giant telecom company merging with a media company. It's rare when it doesn't happen. But it was very different back then. And as a pro wrestling super fan, I know it as the thing that killed WCW because America Online, by buying Time Warner, their stocks outnumbered Ted Turner's, so Ted Turner didn't have the power to prevent people from closing a wrestling company. And so a year later, when AOL Time Warner's like, we don't want to own wrestling anymore, he couldn't, like he did in the 80s, say, well, I'm going to pay for it.
They said goodbye, right? Am I right? Come
yes,
on.
Yeah,
classic
yeah.
quotes. I have to say, before we move on, I love Malcolm in the Middle so much. And I think we need to talk about it one of these days when we do one of our live action cartoon podcasts, because it was good from start to finish. Simpsons people worked on it. And I think now is the perfect time for a rewatch because we all learned life is unfair, as They Might Be Giants sung.
Yeah, I wanted to watch it. I think I did hear about it early because into 1999, I was a mega They Might Be Giants fan. So I had heard ahead of time, they do the theme song of this new show. I'm like, the They Might Be Giants adding credence to this young show called Malcolm in the Middle. But anyway, hey, welcome to our guest, Lindsay Katai. Hello.
Hello. Thank you for having me.
And Lindsay, you're the host of the podcast Teen Creeps. The R.L. Stine episodes, those, I actually read those books as a kid.
They're, oh, did you really? Nice.
Yes, yeah.
A lot of people's introduction is the Goosebumps books.
Mm-hmm.
I was more of a Fear Street guy myself.
Mm-hmm.
A little racier.
That's refreshing. We read the Fear Street books. We tried reading Goosebumps, but they just skew a little bit too young. There are a little bit too many fake outs, too many annoying little brothers, annoying older sisters.
Fear Street even breaks those, the all a dream things too, usually. Yeah, I was a Goosebumps reader who graduated into some Fear Street stuff. I read a few. I when I was listening to your one for The Snowman, I was like, I think I read this one. Like, it was is a weird feeling.
Oh, you listened to an especially weird episode of ours then.
Yes, yeah. That was a lot of fun.
Thanks.
And also you're a writer in comedy and animation as well, right?
Yeah, I am a writer on the now HBO Max original series Infinity Train. It's produced by Cartoon Network Studios. We first aired on Cartoon Network, and now we are streaming exclusively on HBO Max, which really ties into the whole Time Warner story.
AOL is now like such a tiny sliver of that pie, and it's an AT&T company, really. On our What a Cartoon show, we did an episode of Regular Show with Toby Jones and Owen Dennis. Owen's the creator of Infinity War.
Infinity Train.
Infinity Train. I'm so sorry.
I don't think he created Infinity War, but I think
Marvel does not own the term Infinity.
He'd be a little richer, but maybe not much because Marvel.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sorry. Yes.
Oh, there's so many superheroes in this room. I can see why Henry's mind would stray.
Yes. Yeah. Were you a viewer of The Simpsons in your youth?
I was. I started watching it when I was, I think, 13. We didn't watch it before that. My mom thought it was too mature. But then, I discovered it in syndication and started watching it obsessively, was quoting it all the time, had my little Simpsons books with the highlights from all the episodes. What are those series called? Like Everything Simpsons or?
Well, like the guide, the
Everything Guide to Simpsons.
Yeah, the Everything Guide to Simpsons, I think. Yeah.
Yeah.
We hear a lot from people that they were either a child whose parents just let them watch anything, or in their early teens, they finally were free to watch The Simpsons, and that's when they got into it. It's one of those two types of parents.
And luckily, I think the show was only in its maybe like sixth season at that point. Mm-hmm. I was still pretty early in the game.
I mean, once it's syndicated, you can watch in the afternoons, and your parents are less likely to police that time, I guess.
Yeah, it's like it's gotten a 630 seal of approval.
And did, you know, the show influence you any as like a comedy writer?
Yeah, I'm sure it's partly why I'm so into like vaudeville humor. like the monorail episode, jokes like that where it's like Music Man parodies. You said, of course, Ahoy Ahoy to start off the episode. And I recently tried to put that in an Infinity Train script, and I didn't remember it as being a reference to The Simpsons. Everybody in the room was like, you can't use a Simpsons joke. I was like, I'm not using a Simpsons joke. That was Alexander Graham Bell's preferred greeting when you answer the telephone. Does no one else know this? So I don't know. It really jives with my old timey sense of humor.
And has your, you know, professional work brought you in the orbit of any Simpsons folks?
It has not yet. Mm. Yeah, not a lot of Simpsons writers over at Cartoon Network.
Aw.
I would say like 10% of LA's population is now Simpsons writers. You either have written for them or you are writing for them. So
at least you're a PA. You know someone who's a PA on Simpsons.
Yeah. Well, I know Mike Mitchell. Mike Mitchell helped me get the job on Infinity Train, and he was a PA on Simpsons, I think.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, Mike Mitchell of the Birthday Boys.
We love Mike Mitchell. Yeah, we've landed Nick Weiger in the past, but we have not yet gotten Mitch
is a bit harder to pin down. We also have not yet had Mitch on Teen Creeps, but we have had Weiger a few times.
He's a mercurial guy, but that's what we like about him.
Yeah.
So we have a writer's corner up front. So we always do this when there is a new credited writer for the episode. So the writer, of course, of this episode is Carolyn Omine. At this point in history, 20 years ago, it was still very rare to have a woman staff writer on The Simpsons. I think she is like the third or the fourth. There's Jennifer Crittenden, there's Rachel Polito, and Julie Thacker. And this is the number four?
This is number four, yeah. There was...
Wow. Season 11.
Yeah, there was Mimi Pond and Nell Scovell in freelance capacity, right, but not staff. And I believe that is it. And of course, Julie Thacker is a great writer on her own, of course, but she is also married to Mike Scully. So if you're like, you know, I think one, Carolyn Omine, I believe she is the highest ranking woman in the Simpsons hierarchy ever. Like she'd end up being that level.
With,
like
22 years on the show, I would hope so.
Yeah.
So yeah, she was hired at the beginning of season 10 for the first Treehouse episode. So she was a producer in season 10. This is her first credited episode. And I want to go over her history really quickly just to show you where she's been. So her first writing credit was one episode of something called Home Free, which was a one season mid-season show on ABC. It was a Matthew Perry vehicle, like right before Friends started. So not like 10 episodes aired of this. No one remembers it. It's not available anywhere. It's not even on YouTube. Nobody cares about Home Free. This will strike all of us as odd, I think. So she went from Home Free to the final two seasons of Full House.
That was shocking to find out. Yeah, yeah. She that, you know, other than Simpsons, her credits on sitcoms are not the, you know, edgy, critically acclaimed kind. You know, that seemed like she was a bit of a she was
take the jobs you can get.
That's what I was trying to say. Yes, yeah.
I feel like when I was on the message boards and you know, news groups back then, like this was weaponized against her as a writer. Like she came from Full House, and now she's writing on The Simpsons. Like she didn't come from Letterman.
These people know nothing. Exactly. They don't understand.
But like the argument was like, oh, she didn't come from Letterman or SNL or Get a Life. Like Full House? Are you kidding me? But yeah, I mean, I love Full House as a kid. She actually wrote the last episode, Michelle Rides Again, Part 2.
I did look that up. I had forgotten those episodes, that the finale was a two-parter where Michelle gets amnesia. And I think it's an excuse for a clip show, I think. Which,
oh, yeah.
Yeah.
A clip show last episode is a crummy way. I mean, I'm not blaming her. Like, it's just, I think they were probably like, we're definitely being canceled. TGIF is changing.
Yeah.
Let's just sit around on the couch and figure out.
This caused me to look into Full House because I enjoyed it a lot as a kid, and then ironically as like a preteen and teen, and I was like, why didn't this just go on forever? Because it is back now. Mm-hmm. Back then there weren't even 200 episodes, and I was reading like it just got too expensive to make because there's like 12 cast members that have been on the show for 8 years, so you need to pay them all more and more every year. So yeah, that was her role. Then she went on to something called The Parenthood. I think that's a Robert Townsend sitcom. Then Nick Frino, Licensed Teacher, and then she wrote one episode of All Real Monsters and Wild Thornberries, and then Simpsons for the next 22 years.
Yeah, I did find an interview with her to explain why she did Ah Real Monsters and Wild Thornberries, which were her first two animation jobs. And it was, she had gotten into the comedy industry through doing improv comedy in The Groundlings in the late 80s. And one of her former Groundlings troupe members, a man named Mark, he had become the story editor for Ah Real Monsters. And so when she was between jobs and hiatuses for scripts, she's like, oh, I can take one Ah Real Monster script. So that's how she, it's funny, she worked for the Klasky Chupo show before moving on to The Simpsons. She's also from Hawaii, and so this is a legitimately Hawaii show. And I also saw, like, in her, the timing of her hiring is interesting, too, because we talked before about Ian Maxtone Graham. I double-checked this, like, in 1998, he was one of the co-executive producers on the show. And he gave the infamous interview, which included him saying, like, hey, you know, we got no women. This is paraphrasing. He's like, well, we got no women in the writer's room, but it's more of a male show anyway. You know, it's just how the comedy works. So,
yeah.
So good on Carolyn for getting in there. And she's definitely been, I've found multiple interviews where she's like, yeah, it's tough being the only woman. I'm trying to help in comedy to expand this stuff. I also know from her Twitter that she's a big Bernie Sanders supporter.
That's
so
right. Yeah.
I like, that made me like her even more. I was like, yeah, thumbs up, Carolyn. And
progressive.
And also I saw that I think it's 2005. She has been the primary voice director of the cast, too.
Oh, I didn't know that. Okay.
Or at least a bit of one. I found an interesting interview where Nancy Cartwright was interviewing her about it, and they brought up the voice director thing. And I wonder if she does it a little less now, because in her most recent season, she's a consulting producer. She had been an executive producer, but I think she just scaled back her time there. But like on The Simpsons Game and Simpsons Tapped Out, she's the credited voice voice director on that too. So
interesting.
Yeah,
you can really see how these people's careers, how they're shaped, really express how Hollywood changes, because like everyone left for these development deals in the mid 90s. Mm, yeah. There are no more of those now. So like if you were hired for The Simpsons in 1998 or 99, you're still there.
Yes,
because the getting's good.
Once you're in that club, who wants to leave it, you know? And yeah, the last thing I want to say about Omine is that she wrote, she still writes for the show. She wrote two episodes in season 31 that were pretty good, I would say. She did the one where Marge works at a pot dispensary. Hmm. And she did the season finale that just aired in May that was inexplicably a Christmas episode. I don't know. Why didn't they hold that one till Christmas? I don't know. But it was about Santa's little helper growing up, and Kate Blanchett plays a dog psychologist that helps Santa's little helper. And the funny thing is they actually show a clip from the Simpsons Christmas special in it. Hmm. And they bring back the guy who was his trainer, who said, like, get out of here. And so he looks ridiculous drawn in the 31 style.
I think they brought him back in like season 14 too. Like when Al Jean came back. So it's like, I think they might've even redesigned him from there.
Oh, right. Yeah. I forgot that they used that guy like twice. But yeah, Carolyn Amine is an underrated part of the Simpsons for the last like 20 years that I'm getting to know more and more, especially thanks to like social media. She's one of the more active Simpsons writers on Twitter, which is cool.
I'm gonna have to follow her.
Yeah, Lindsay, I know you're a big Sanders supporter as well.
Like, I am, yeah.
This is a pro Sanders podcast, so but yeah,
good among friends.
The next time you're at a fundraiser, like, see if you can find Carolyn and But yeah, yes, this episode begins. Well, first there's a couch gag about making art out of dung, which I'm guessing it's a reference to. There was a controversial 1996 painting of the Virgin Mary made out of elephant dung. So I think it's a reference to that.
I was searching and searching, trying to figure out what that was a reference to, because I knew it had to be a reference to something.
I forgot.
Otherwise, it's just a very lame joke.
Yeah, for like going into this, I thought like, oh, Bart's being a rascal. It's a classic Bart prank. But no, it's like the one I always think of is Piss Christ, not Mary Dung.
It was a risk I took Googling art made out of poop. That was
paid off.
Yes. Do that after
fortune
lunch.
Fortune favors the bold.
And this episode opens with like a minute long Itchy and Scratchy short. This is the longest Itchy and Scratchy we've seen in a long time. I think.
Feel like they've been gone for a while.
Yeah, this feels like an intentional like season 4 throwback to have them watch a long Itchy and Scratchy thing.
There's even like little stills from past episodes in the scrapbook. Like you can see like previous realistic Scratchy deaths that actually happened.
Oh yeah, I have each of those referenced in the photo album. It's the one of Scratchy with losing all of his guts. That's from My Dinner with Itchy. That was in Homer Defined. There's the Bond laser thing. That is from the short Spay Anything. That was in Cape Fear. And the bomb eyes are from the short Messenger of Death, which is in Itchy and Scratchy and Marge. So they actually cared about their history. And same with Poochie is there. Poochie is in the show, which Krusty promised in a legally binding sense that Poochie would never be seen again.
Yeah, that's true.
It's funny. Well, yeah, Poochie's alive.
File suit.
Poochie is alive in a scene where Scratchy is dead.
Yeah,
what's going on here?
I know. This is xylophone bone logic here that I feel wrong. And also sheep cloning was very new at the time too. Like, so there's a lot of like ripped from the headlines things here. I wonder if it's intentional, but in an episode that will later feature Lucille Ball, that there is like, it's kind of a Lucy conveyor belt joke of Itchy cloning all the Scratchies and he can't keep up with killing all of them at the same time. I also really like the comically short life of a cloned Scratchy that you're like, I'm alive. Ah, I'm alive. Like,
no time for the hug. Just right into the killing machine.
So good. The cloning machine into a killing machine is it's a really good gag. And it cuts to Homer watching it with the kids. Homer doesn't usually watch Itchy and Scratchy with them, so that's kind of cute. I like that. But also, though, that Homer is infantile in this episode. And also, like, I know I say Homer's too mean in a lot of these season 11 ones, but Homer's really too mean in this one.
He's a mean child.
Yes.
But he is infantilized from the very beginning, I think, on purpose.
He's immediately mixed in with the kids the whole episode.
He's like on their level from the beginning.
Yep. I do like there's one little point after this TV scene where Marge is like spying on them. There's like a prominent hair ruffle as she's like her hair brushes past the entryway. I mean, we see those all the time, but there's like even a sound.
I think
the director Mark Kirkland, he loves doing that, like always finding a way to like smash Marge's hair down in the car, have the hair like flip when she goes through a door.
There's a lot of hair work in this episode. Yeah, I missed that one early. And yeah, who among us were pack rats as a kid who would refuse to let a parent like get rid of anything? Like I definitely had that problem.
I still hang on to too much stuff.
My parents did not have time to get like personally involved in my things. Mm-hmm. So I was lucky, I guess. They weren't like, "What's going on in your closet?" Just like they were busy working and stuff and drinking.
Important work.
You know, my mom also, though, she held on to things for too long too, so it's more like we kind of supported each other in keeping things. She wouldn't so much do the Marge throwing out thing. I had to do this when I last moved apartments like 3 years ago. That's when I finally had to go like, I can't move this entire full closet of garbage to my new place. Like, I just had to throw it out and not think about what I was throwing out.
I mean, there was talk in our house for about a decade of a fabled yard sale that would, you know, get rid of all these things, but it never happened.
I really felt for Marge when they do get the stuff back from the Goodwill truck, because the adult part of my brain now is like, no, it was gone. You were never going to think about it again. Oh, God, now it's still here.
You were finally
like,
free.
Really identified with that.
I was like instilled with this idea that you have to keep the box for something, and it's something that I still have to fight. It was like something my grandma and my mom like instilled in me, but I don't know why, because the things never go back in the box. The way they're packed, it's like impossible to get them back. And if you move, you just wrap them in like a blanket or bubble wrap or whatever. It just, I don't know why. I hope like future parents aren't telling their kids, "I saved the box."
I have that biggest problem still with video game consoles. Like, that's the one. Whenever I get a new video game console, up to the Switch a few years ago, I was like, "Oh, man, this box technically is like a $300 box. What if I do need it for something?" And then I eventually, of course, just throw away that box when I get the new system. I'm like, all right, I didn't need this.
I actually do tend to keep my boxes, and I use them.
Ooh.
To keep the things in?
Sorry
or?
To brag, a but box reuser. I do put things back in the box to store them and move.
I think me keeping that Switch box, though, is even sillier, because I keep... I already spent the money on a, you know, zipper pouch that keeps my Switch safe in it. So why do I need my box and that zipper pouch?
Safer than any box.
The Simpsons will be right back.
Welcome to the break, everybody, and we hope you're enjoying this on your candy phones. And a big thank you to our guest, Lindsay Katai. You should definitely be checking out all the cool stuff she does. Follow her on Twitter, watch Infinity Train on HBO Max, and check out her very fun podcast, Teen Creeps. We're big fans of Lindsay here, and we thank her for her time. Now, if you enjoy this podcast but wish you could hear not this ad, but also more podcasts, have I got the recipe for you. Head over to patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. This podcast is supported by subscribers just like you, who, if they signed up at $5 a month, they not only get to know that me and Bob do this full time as our real ass jobs, but also they get dozens and dozens of exclusive podcasts only for them. If you're a $5 subscriber, you can hear our many mini series of podcasts covering shows like The Critic, Futurama, King of the Hill, and most recently we went through every episode of Mission Hill in the same Simpsons style, along with a brand new interview with the creators of the show, Simpsons legends Bill Oakley and Josh Weinstein. Check out all of that right now at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. And you want something even fancier than the Electric Needle Room? Then you should sign up at the $10 level at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. That premium level gets you all that $5 stuff, plus dozens and dozens more hours of podcasts. Me and Bob each month do a premium podcast, What a Cartoon Movie. That's where we cover different animated features once a month, often for over 4 hours. Films like Ghost in the Shell, Space Jam, Iron Giant, Aladdin, A Goofy Movie, Spider-Man in the Spider-Verse, and many, many more. You can learn all about those in depth if you upgrade your $5 subscription or just start at $10 a month at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. And but yes, in our first clip here, Marge tries her best to get rid of some junk.
What's in the box, Mom?
This box? Oh, nothing.
Are you sure? You sound nervous.
Well, anyone would be nervous with all the economic turmoil you read about in the...
Get her! She's doing something!
It's a Goodwill truck! She cleaned up the attic!
Her junk! And the exits are sealed. Got a plan B. Come on!
Go! Go!
I'm trying! Stop yelling at me!
I want to know more about that guy.
Yeah, he's having a hard day, that guy. But I also like that they won't let Marge do anything. They're just like, she's doing stuff. Like, even Lisa's against her here.
I was going to say, I really love an episode where Lisa sucks, too. she's being, like, childish and shitty. Even though, like, later in the episode, that obviously turns around quite a bit. But it's always fun when Lisa isn't, you know, the picture of human development.
Yeah, do you think sometimes they write Lisa a little too perfect or too grown up?
No, because that is her character. But for that reason, it's just fun when that breaks a bit, like when she gets to be more of a kid.
To me, it even feels more like a horror movie because how Lisa's looking at the TV. She doesn't even turn to Marge. And she's just like, what are you doing, Mom?
Maybe that's why that hair noise was put in, because it's like a tell, you know, for the family.
I was going to say, yeah, they want to draw attention to the fact that Marge is doing stuff before they even notice.
And there's some great squash and stretch of Marge rushing out the door, too. I got a good, like, weird pause on her, like, stretched out body as she's zipping out the door there.
On the commentary, they said they had to cheat to, like, you cannot see the TV room from the front door. It's, like, impossible because there's, like, the living room and then the TV room past that. So they had to, like, kind of cheat the layout of the house to get that scene to work. But I didn't notice until they pointed it out.
I noticed that it was an angle I wasn't used to, and then they use it again in the part of the episode where Bart and Homer are watching supposedly I Love Lucy.
Yes. You didn't even strike me until I heard the commentary that it was wrong. And I'm one of the most pedantic people about this show there is. But I never really think about the layout of the house, though. But yeah, it should be stairs into the stairs go to the front door. And then it's, yeah, the side room, not the TV room. I like that Kirkland is already by season 11 has been doing The Simpsons for so long that he knows what's wrong about it there. And so they chase out the door. There's a good gag of Homer getting stuck in the dog door and ripping it out through the door. I wonder if it was a late addition that there's one shot where Homer is running and the door falls off him. Do you think like that was a retake because they realized like, oh, Homer's not wearing the door in the next shot. We need to have the door falling off of him as he runs, or it feels like a unneeded. If he showed up without the dog door on him in the next shot, I wouldn't have really questioned what happened
to
it.
Kind of like the watch that will just appear when someone needs to tell the time.
Yeah. the magic cartoon watch.
I can also see them thinking that that would be fun to show the door falling off.
I like the physics of it. It's very realistic how it just flops off there.
Yeah.
And yeah, so Homer not only runs onto the back of it, but jumps off of it after grabbing the aqua box and stuff. That's such a funny series of drawings there.
That's great how he just tumbles while keeping the box level, just rolling backwards. That's, very good.
And yes, as they get the box back, they're reminiscing about their stuff here in this next clip, and I really love all the specifics of it here.
Ooh, that was scary. We came this close to losing our spare Christmas tree stand, you monster.
Look, here's the box for my pitch back. If I still had it, I could put it in here.
I'll never get rid of this useless junk.
Useless? This flash cube has 2 flashes left.
You guys never use any of this stuff. Look at these. You bought them after the Nagano Olympics and never skied once. If you would just stop being so impulsive, maybe...
Hey, let's go skiing right now!
Yeah, Dad, let's go skiing! Now, Dad!
No!
Gotta say, this upper, lower, middle class family has ski equipment for 5 people. What's going on here?
Yeah.
It is funny.
That's the true lack of reality to this cartoon.
I can't stand it. I think like a lot of the LA writer lifestyle does infect the show about the regular family, because it's like skiing was never on the table for my family.
I have never been skiing in my life. Lindsay, have you been skiing ever?
No, I haven't. But I was born in Reno, and my mom skied quite a bit when she lived in Tahoe.
Oh, nice.
I honestly think there's a lot of skiing jokes, and of course the Winter Olympics were in 98, and there's a lot of the jokes about skiing accidents, and I think it was because Sonny Bono died in January of 98.
Around
the time this episode would have been written, so I think that was just them having skiing, antics on the brain.
Wow, hadn't even thought of that. Man, I thought the reference to that Winter Olympics in Japan, like that, it was basically 2 years before this aired, so that was the most recent Winter Olympics. But yeah, I didn't even think of the Sonny Bono tragedy that definitely affected, like, if you were a Gen X kid, you grew up on the Sonny and Cher show, so his death was probably pretty memorable to you. Cher still with us, knocking on wood there.
By the time this episode comes out,
she's great on Twitter. Sometimes,
No, that's a danger of recording 8 weeks ahead of time right now. I'm knocking on wood, but we seem to have gotten out of the woods with Ed Asner, and I'm just saying, and this is easily edit outable if I'm wrong.
Reality changes every month, I would say, drastically. So by August, like, Alf will have been declared an enemy of the state by the president. We don't know what's going to happen next.
Infinity Train was nominated for an Annie Award, and Ed Asner was the presenter of the award at the ceremony.
Oh, that's
we didn't
awesome.
Win, but that would have been very exciting.
I mean, just to breathe the same air as him is pretty great.
Yeah, he was great.
Man, that's awesome. Like, he's like 94 or something, right?
Yeah,
that's...
and he was killing his comedy bits in the...
Oh, that's great, man.
In the presenting.
That's why, again, we said it a million times, but they got to bring back Gargoyles fast just to get him in the one more job in there. But I also like that they've done this a few times in the Scully years, but I like that Marge often represents the audience who's just like, you're so impulsive and you just decide on the drop of a hat to change where you are. And it's really stressful for Marge. She's like, and that explains why they just decide, oh, the Simpsons go skiing. Like, this episode is kind of all over the place in where it goes and what happens.
It's like a rare two cold open episode where the thing they start out with leads to the main plot. In this, there's like the thing they start out with leads to another thing, and then it leads to the main plot.
Yeah,
you'll never guess the skiing trip leads to Hawaii later.
Yeah.
And a visit from Lucille Ball.
The one, and you know, in the past, like it was a very season 3 and 4 way of thinking of, oh, this script is a little short, a minute of itchy and scratchy, that'll fill it up. Like, so I think that might be a why itchy and scratchy is in here too. They just ended up with a shorter script and they realized too late. That's how you end up with a double opening. Also, we've talked about how some recent ones have felt like it was a too short first act. This first act is like 8 minutes. Like, it is a lengthy first act for the series.
Yeah, the story with Lisa being Marge's replacement is actually pretty short. It feels like a minor part of the episode almost.
I think if it went more than 4 minutes, you'd feel even worse because Lisa comes in so much. And also, too, they head up to the snowy mountain, and the ski lift operator really looks like he's supposed to look like Mike Scully on the commentary. Scully's like, "Is that me?"
Or an animator's friend.
Yeah, it's usually Lindsay. Have you been drawn into Infinity Train yet?
No. Aww. Hopefully, if we keep getting to make more, maybe. Well, then, I have done a couple of voices, though, so that was fun.
Oh, that's good. Okay. Everybody who has HBO Max listening to this needs to start streaming it right now just so you can be drawn into the show.
Thank you.
There's a joke about the drummer for Bread, which definitely feels like a Mike Scully kind of joke.
It does feel like the kind of music that Homer would be into, you know, on Homer Palooza.
And I have to assume that drummer for Bread they're referring to is Mike Botts, who was a member of the band until Bread broke up in 1997. And Mike Botts would pass away from cancer in 2005.
Mm, so. Related to the Babysitter Bandit, I hope, right?
That's a great band. I love Bread.
I don't know a song from them. I bet if I heard it, I'd be like, oh, that's Brad. Okay.
When they broke up, did someone say, "Guys, we're toast"? I'm out of here.
God, I hope.
speaking of toast, Homer is horribly burned in the next because of that. But it's funny. They start with the itchy and scratchy, like cartoonish violence, and then Homer goes through basically the same thing of being frozen solid and then melted with hot flames.
I don't know if the flamethrower is a regular feature on the ski the ski slopes. Another thing, like this always happens when I'm watching the episodes on the DVD, where like I'll pause and then I'll activate a deleted scene on accident. And there's like, if you're wondering where Maggie is, she's like on this baby luge.
Oh, okay.
And there's like a luge full of babies.
Yeah, Maggie.
I didn't even hit me that Maggie was missing.
Actually, I think it's a bobsled because a luge you go down alone.
Okay.
And a bobsled you're with a bunch of people.
Yeah.
Mostly Jamaican.
I should have checked out that baby bobsled cut. Well, also, another bit that reminded me of my childhood was remembering when me and my brother were kind of like Bart and Lisa, when we'd realize like our mom was afraid of heights, or if we were in like, say, the teacup rides and we knew that she was getting more scared of it than we were, we'd be like, oh, let's make it go faster and scare mom.
Finally,
like,
we have the power.
Yes, yeah, yeah. I feel bad about that now. but Bart and Lisa, again, this is more Bart and Lisa acting like real kids. I like that.
Mm-hmm.
And also how Marge, then I definitely feel like Marge, when you would get to the top of those ski lifts, I'd be like, and back down again. I'm just going to not get out of this seat. That's what's always scared me from skiing anyway. Just not even the actual like physical activity of skiing, but just the hopping off one of those ski lifts. Like, it just feels so precarious. Like, yeah. And yes, it's all.
Can't relate. Sorry. My middle class family, as we talked about, couldn't really afford to keep skiing. So
on rides like that, do you get scared, or you deal okay with like heights?
Actually, I am fine with rides, but heights, so recently my boyfriend Mike was having me try to play Zelda Breath of the Wild on the Switch, because I started playing Animal Crossing a lot, and he was like, well, if you like running around a pretty area now that we're stuck in quarantine, you should try this. And hopping up the tower, my body was having a physical reaction as though I was actually in danger.
Oh, wow.
My palms were sweating. I was scared. I like pushed it onto him. And then I tried the VR that Mike bought. And that was just terrifying.
Yeah.
So while I can handle rides, I can't handle heights, even in theory.
It's funny when you were bringing up Breath of the Wild, I was just thinking, like, I just got a VR set. And I was thinking, I hate real roller coasters. I don't like baby ones. So I'm going to try to do one of like the roller coaster sims on there and see what it's like. I bet I will just throw it off my head immediately, like I do with horror games. Like, no,
well, also,
no.
And I don't know if this is just because I wear glasses or if this would have happened regardless, but just so dizzy. I was so dizzy. Mm.
Yeah, you know, I'm a glasses wearer. The only VR I've used for a big length of time is the PlayStation VR, which that headset is big enough for my glasses to fit in it, but I can only do it for about 10 minutes until I start to feel too queasy. And the height thing hit me in that when I played, I think it's just on PlayStation, but it's not a game per se, but it is a Spider-Man experience where you're basically like, I'm Spider-Man in the world of Spider-Man Homecoming. And like, it starts with like, here you are, Spider-Man, standing on the edge of a building, shoot your web. I'm like, ah! how many hours have you put into Animal Crossing? I got to be at least at 80 myself.
At 80?
Yeah.
Oh, I think I'm probably at 140.
Wow.
Man. We're in late June. Yeah. I'm still waiting for KK Slider, but I think I'm around 70 to 80.
Oh, and soon.
Yeah, I've gotten really into it in quarantine, and I don't play video games. This is the one.
I played a ton of all the previous Animal Crossings, and then this one was just a wonderful warm blanket in a time of trouble.
Perfect release date, too.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I got to think, I'm starting to think this was intentional by Nintendo. That's,
Q told me a few things.
What did they know, and how long did they know it?
We're delaying this game. No reason.
Well, in about a week from now, too, you're going to finally be able to swim and dive in that game. I'm looking forward to that. But
what?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You hadn't seen an update coming.
I don't keep up on news. I'm not very good about that.
Keep an eye out. I believe it's July 3rd. They're going to update it that you can swim. You'll be able to swim.
Oh, my God.
But yes, well, this episode, though, we now are coming to the part that is easily the most remembered part of this episode.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Which Homer's off by himself. He is in this clip. He's looking at a bunch of signs that describe parts of the mountain. The one Homer doesn't say out loud is at the bottom. It's the Decapitator. This leads to one of the sexiest of moments in the show's history in this clip.
The Widowmaker. Oh, that one's for the ladies. Spinebuster. Boring. Ooh, Colostomizer. Don't hurt me. Here's my wallet.
Hi, diddly ho, shoes in boots.
Flanders? That suit's a little revealing, isn't it?
Well, it allows for maximum mobility. Feels like I'm wearing nothing at all.
Quit it! Must wash eyes!
Uh-oh.
Okay, don't panic. Remember what the instructor said.
If you ever get into trouble, all you need to do is...
Feels like I'm wearing nothing at all. Nothing at all. Nothing at all.
Stupid sexy Flanders. Ow, my leg. This is the worst pain ever.
So, yeah, the director calls out his assistant director, Josh Tabak, for a lot of this stuff, like all the Homer skiing antics, the very funny, disgusted Homer face when he's trying to push the image of Ned's butt out of his eye, out of his head. Just like a very unique kind of off-model face that makes it a lot funnier.
Oh, yeah.
I love that face of Homer's. I can think about it right now. I can just picture it.
And, yeah, I mean, Flanders before had already been drawn as surprisingly fit even under his sweater, which in his normal character design, he has a slight paunch like most Simpsons males do. So when he takes his shirt off in, you know, season three, well, it's really season four, but season three production episode, Streetcar Named Marge, he takes his shirt off and he has an amazing body. So they've stuck with that since. But this one of the reveal of like his perfect body with painted on clothes, we've never seen his butt to this level of detail before. Yeah.
His butt is dancing.
It's an amazing butt for the show. And I in like three episodes, we'll learn even more about Flanders' anatomy. But
oh, God. Yeah.
But this became a meme, I think, because it's just such a memorable joke. Like, not just the funny drawing of Ned's butt, but also this, it's about being distracted by something that you don't want to be sexy. I think it works. It works in that meme fashion as well.
Yeah, Ned's in this episode a lot. I forgot how much he's in this.
Right? Yeah. And just the shot of Homer's crazy, disgusted face with his thought balloon having a zoom in on Ned's butt is just a very funny drawing. And I also didn't realize shush means going downward on skis. So that's what shush in boots is the cute name.
Okay.
Yeah. I did not know that. I've never been skiing. Did not know skiing terminology.
Frankly, there's too much skiing terminology.
And the pain in Homer's legs, like his legs break. Like he breaks his legs before Marge does in this episode.
But he's immediately ready to go back for more.
Yes. Yeah. It's based on that joke and the end of this episode, Homer seems to have no memory of pain. Like pain leaves his mind instantly. Then we have a bit of a joke of Lisa being somebody who insists on doing old school cross-country skiing of just...
This whole bit is so odd.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. Lisa...
I really enjoy it, but it's just like, where does this come from?
It is a joke at Lisa's expense, which happens a lot around this time in the show, but I do like her goody-goody. Like, I'm going to do like the cardio, fun, not fun skiing activity, which is cross-country skiing. So no slopes, no thrills, just like a flat landscape and lots of work.
And these bloodthirsty deer definitely fit with the many times they do a joke of like Lisa trying to do the right like environmentalist thing and being punished by like unbelievable happenstance, like when she saves a fish and just throws it in the ocean and a shark eats it, or she's like, oh, these dolphins are nice, and then dolphins take over the world in a Treehouse of Horror episode.
The ranger that saves her is from Mountain of Madness.
Yeah.
But it's Hank Azaria doing a different voice.
Yeah, it seems like he forgot what that voice was.
Or he just didn't know what drawing they would make him.
I think it was smart of them to be like, why are
we...
Yeah,
maybe that was a callback they hadn't decided on yet.
Yeah, we've been noticing a lot this season. The animators, I think, are doing callbacks that the writers aren't considering, like the Maryworth phone drawn in the Maryworth guy's office. Like, I would doubt the script said, Maryworth phone is here, but... The artist kind of draw it in. Plus, I mean, why fully design a new park ranger when you already had a perfectly good park ranger you've used before?
That was their other chairlift joke, which I appreciate.
Oh, yeah.
It'll show you everything directly under the chairlift. A good view of that.
That's a great joke. Also, Lisa gets in a good little eep there. I think, too, the deer's turning bloodthirsty. I saw Omine in one of her interviews. She talked about an inspiration for her when she joined The Simpsons was John Swartzwelder. Like, that was one of her, or maybe her favorite writer before she joined The Simpsons. And this is a very kind of Swartzweldery turn here, too.
If you're slaving away at a Full House, trying to think of things for the new babies to say, the new cute babies, I'm sure you're like, God, if only I was writing jokes about angry deer that are going to kill a little girl.
Okay, then we have a quick joke about boarding and all of the catchphrases you say, which they just remind me of late 90s snowboarding video games and all the commercials for
it. And blasting a dookie is what Bart refers to as going number two. You know, I don't think I was a sheltered child, but when I bought the Green Day album Dookie, I didn't know for like a year Dookie meant poop.
Oh,
like,
really?
No one ever called poop Dookie in my neck of the woods.
I didn't know for a long time either.
Okay.
Yeah.
I wasn't alone then.
I think somebody had to tell me when it was new. That it was,
hey, you know what Green Day actually means? That means you smoke a lot of weed.
Oh, I did.
In a day.
Wow, I'm learning right now that that's what Green Day means.
And I was allowed to buy that.
What a crass band.
Yeah. They
so
should
crass.
They should not have been selling those records.
You can find out what Longview is about on our Patreon.
See, that one I did know. I'm very, I can't believe I didn't know the other that Green Day meant that. Also, with all these snowboarding, the snowboarding instructor jokes, they reminded me of the South Park Aspen episode.
Oh, yeah.
And I checked, like, that episode's 2 years after this, so it's, if anyone was ripping people off, it was South Park.
But they were more going for the boob comedy, ski school, Aspen Extreme kind of thing.
The Savage Steve Holland classic, Better Off Dead.
Mm.
Yes, then we go into the lodge, and Marge is getting hit on by Disco Stew. Honestly, his aggressiveness.
I love to see Disco Stew. I was so excited.
I like that he has a different outfit for the ski lodge, too. That...
And he was previously talking to Edna, probably striking out.
Oh, yeah,
but
you're right.
It is very cute that Marge doesn't understand she's being hit on and just is confused.
Yeah.
And she's like, "That's you're sitting on the armrest. Why are you sitting so close to me? This is weird."
And also, she is unaware of what asking to party means as well, which is... sweet.
Like with hats?
whatever you need for Stu to get his thing on. He's super creepy here. And also, he's singing a song that is a reference to a real song. Mm. The 1976 Johnny Taylor song, Disco Lady. Here's here's the real thing as it was performed on Soul Train. Yeah, there we go. Move it in, move it out, Disco Lady.
Around the time I was watching The Simpsons, I got very into disco.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because of the disco compilation CDs that were being sold on TV.
Oh, cool. The ones
that Pure Disco.
The ones that are just a list of songs and then like every fifth song they name.
Probably.
I mean, in recent times,
I
think...
Yeah, I know what you mean now.
In recent times, I think we've all come around to thinking like, oh no, disco is fun and cool. And it's like, I think back then it was like, you know what's better? Every AC/DC song that sounds exactly the same. That's music.
Yeah, disco music, I'm upset about how long jokes about it lasted because it's just dance. It's pop. It's dance pop music that we listen to now. Yeah. But the joke about like, oh, disco is terrible lasted for so long.
I think it is because the anti-disco teens of the 70s, they're the ones who took over much of American pop culture. Yeah.
Yep, but they're wrong. Disco's great.
Did Disco Stew make you more or less into disco?
I think I just felt like that was like a for me, like talking about Disco Stew, I was like, that joke's for me. I love disco.
And then the kids interrupt his flirting with Marge, and he realizes he dodged a bullet by going after a woman with kids, which...
I love the back away, not today, disco lady.
And Marge then talks about why she doesn't want to be skiing, including the term fanny first, which UK listeners, let us know if that was cut from your airings of it. I wonder.
Yeah. I was thinking about that. I was like, which did they mean, though?
I'm sure Marge, whenever Marge says it, she means it in like the 60s mom way of the nicest way of saying but.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, then Marge gets honestly very painfully injured in this next clip.
Move it in, shove it out, disco lady. Is the seat taken?
I think that's an armrest.
So, do you potty?
You mean like hats and noisemakers kind of party?
Sure, baby, whatever your trip is. Disco Stew wants you to be comfortable while he does his thing.
Who's Disco Stew? Hi, pumpkins.
Kids, back away, not today. Disco lay there.
Have you been in here all day?
You missed all the fun.
Skiing fanny first into a crevasse isn't my idea of fun. The only risk I'm taking is running out of marshmallows. Ow!
Somebody get a doctor! Oh, man, another clock accident.
No wonder. Look at this.
Oh, boy. Crevasse is a funny thing to make Marge say.
Yeah.
But I was laughing very loudly in my apartment. The turning of the nail and just how heavy the thing is and how they put it on the nail and it starts to like shift a little and they back away from it.
Immediately it shifted. Yeah, and it takes two giant men to pick it up. I forgot the gag of Marge saying, like, who's Disco Stew? Like, for us as Simpsons viewers, we all know who Disco Stew is, but Marge is incredibly ignorant of his, like, she doesn't know Disco Stew exists.
How dare she? He bought a jacket from them.
Yeah.
She bought that, yeah. Well, and, boy, I'm trying to remember any other...
Or wait, I'm sorry. He didn't buy the jacket from them.
He almost did.
He doesn't advertise.
His friend didn't know
Lindsay.
Him. His friend was the one.
They've had an interaction before, but who's going to remember every disco man you meet in your life?
Especially in Springfield.
Yeah, I mean, Mr. Burns never remembers who the Simpsons are, so.
Yeah, and Disco Stu has had, he's done a lot of the powder in his time, and I don't mean skiing, so. Yeah, also, it just feels like a typical joke of this time where Marge is doing the safest thing possible and is punished by fate with horrible accident just because the world is mean to Marge. And then I for the first time got the joke about the hospitals, that the Jewish hospital is too nice and expensive for Homer, Catholic too cheap, Presbyterian right in the middle. That's a good little religion joke there.
And because of that, the hospital is temporarily renamed for this episode.
I couldn't believe they gave a shit that
much. I loved
much.
This joke.
And also Disco Stu's like outro gag and the act of just, yeesh, can't believe she went home with those guys.
Yeah.
And this next act here, it reminds me both of Trash of the Titans and because I watched the pilot for the Mike Scully, Mel Gibson, Savages.
Oh, but yeah, yeah.
Both have the plot of, without a woman to clean up after a man, men are disgusting pigs and will just live in their own slop. Like,
yeah, actually, this episode idea was assigned to Carolyn. It was Mike Scully's idea, and she brought the Hawaii stuff into it. But because this happened to him when he was a kid, like their mom went to the hospital for like a week. And the house became an absolute mess. Like, nobody did anything. And she came home to a horrible mess. So that horrible tale of a mom in danger became sitcom gold, I guess.
That's what you have to do. You draw from your life.
Yeah, that them being surrounded by all their trash. Like, the Bart and Homer just amass trash if they are not cleaned up every second by Marge.
Or dressed.
Yes, even dressed, yeah. But yeah, Marge, well, also the length of time in this episode Marge is in the hospital is kind of random as well here too.
It seems unclear.
There's a bit where Marge does say amount of time later.
Yeah. A week, right? It's a week.
But it would have to be like 6 weeks.
Yeah.
Compound fracture. Yeah.
Yeah. I had a clean, listeners know I broke my arm once, but I did not have a cast, but that was not a compound fracture. It was just a single break and it mended over time. But it took 4 months before I could even just move my arm again. Like,
They do give Marge a cane in like one scene later. Like, oh, she's okay, folks.
I do like that at least, you know, Lisa gets it pretty rough in this episode as like almost punishment for daring to try to help her father and brother. But I like they at least give her kind of a moment of challenging fate of saying like, I bet I could be even more efficient than you, Mom. Like that makes it clear that she almost, what's the word I'm looking for?
She's
like
hoisted by her own petard.
Yes. Yeah. I didn't want to say like she earned it by thinking that, but
the hubris alone. She's like, yeah. I could probably improve on the mom stuff as a little girl.
Yeah. Like she thinks that Marge is not doing it well.
Though Lisa, by this point, should know, like, Bart and Homer will never, ever help her with anything, ever. But, oh, well. And then there's a joke about interferons, which I believe on the commentary, Meyer is even like a little embarrassed at how sweaty that is.
They made the one interferon pun you could make. And the perfect place for it is a hospital.
Which apparently interferons are used to treat cancer or some cancers. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. We passed over
and
it.
And
yeah, it'll clear them up real fast. Unfortunately, it costs thousands of dollars for that IV bag. But like the title of this episode is reference to the Dustin Hoffman movie, Little Big Man.
Oh, right.
It has nothing to do with this episode at all, but I think it's a movie that no one really talks or thinks about, so that might be lost in some people.
It's about Native Americans, right?
Isn't I think so.
Of? Yeah. I mean, let's I'm probably better off not knowing what that is about. I remember stocking it on video shelves when I worked at a video store and thinking like, I've never heard of this Dustin Hoffman film. But yes, the next day Lisa is learning how hard things are going to be, including as Homer arrives at the breakfast table in his underpants.
Morning.
Dad, where are your clothes?
I don't know.
Don't tell me Mom dresses you.
I guess, or one of her friends.
Okay, now we're gonna draw jobs from the chore hat.
Come on, bikini inspector. Scrub toilet. Okay, that was the practice. Practice. Okay, here we go. Feed fish.
I'll supervise. You know, the reason for the hat...
Oh, it's a great hat. No one's questioning the hat.
Will you at least do the dishes?
Lisa, I'll do the dishes when I pick it out of the chore hat, and it's not a practice. See? There it is. But that was a practice. The system works.
I love all the kid logic he uses.
Yeah, it's... but when... Okay, they have to make Homer so childish in this because... Otherwise, he is too. He's mean to Lisa in an adult way, and it feels way worse.
Yeah, I think like Homer forgets he's an adult when Marge is not around.
It works.
I like too that their way of feeding the fish is to put dirty dishes in there and hope they just eat the food off of it. Which I gotta think that kills the fish. Like those fish are dead. But also that Homer thinks one of Marge's friends must dress him every morning, if not her. That's pretty great. But yes, I mean, this also feels like it calls to mind being in a roommate scenario and trying to find a way to share their chores responsibly and it not happening. I've been in that with roommates.
Yeah, it's just like, hey, take out the garbage. Some of that garbage in there is yours, you know. Just like, okay, do you want to break it all down?
For me, it was usually a standoff about who was going to empty the dishwasher.
Dishwasher probably would have helped in my roommate scenario. Now I live with my husband, but you know, in my roommate days, I usually did the majority of the dishes with the understanding that the other person, that she would take out the trash more often. But I think that ended up being like a double passive aggressive thing where each of us thought the other did more than the other. Like I would think to myself, I wash the dishes way more than you take out the trash. And then, you know.
Classic.
This is the your 20s is being in a bad roommate scenario as you both learn to not be children anymore. That's what I think. But poor Lisa, she's trying to be as fair as possible with this chore hat. And it feels like both Homer and Bart are just counting on the relaxed sexism of society just to be like, well, you'll just do it because you're the girl. Like, we'll just let that happen. It's kind
again,
of
classic.
Yeah, I guess by trying to be fair, they are finding outs in this.
Yes, yeah.
Instead of her just assigning them stuff, she's giving them a chance and they're just taking advantage of it.
Oh, I mean, also that like Bart saying he'll supervise, like that too is such an easy job, especially for like, I mean, I've had that at jobs I worked at where a person could take a different job, but they're like, you know, I'll supervise on that thing. I'm a supervisor now. And so in a way, I'm actually your boss instead of doing something. that was like in the video store.
Yeah.
In this next scene, Lisa becomes her most like motherly in the whole episode too, which I love this scene, especially because I leave it asking myself, like, so did Lisa not go to school today? What happened?
Here are your lunches. No trading your fruit for firecrackers.
Oh, but Lenny just got some bottle rockets.
You stay away from Lenny. Huh. And where's your sweater, Bart?
It unraveled on a nail.
That's not true. He left it on the bus.
You're dead, Squealer.
Lisa, help!
Those boys of mine.
I love that joke so much. I love any kind of like Totino's pizza roll.
Yes.
Like my hungry guys.
And then also Homer not only becomes a kid for this scene, but the younger brother. Like
he forgets that he regularly strangles Bart in this scene.
And then also he has to be like warned to stay away from Lenny. Lenny as a name to say is a good line.
Yeah. Just include
him. I love her tone there. I thought that Yardley Smith's delivery of each one of these lines is perfect because the tone is just dead on, like, you stay away from Lenny. Those boys of mine.
I just really
liked the delivery of all of them.
It lets Yardley play Lisa in a very different way than she normally gets to. I would hope she had a lot of fun with that too. You know, we'd said earlier in this season that season 11 doesn't have a Lisa episode.
Yeah, I realized that while I was watching. I was like, oh yeah, this is it.
But I mean, you're forgiven for, we're both forgiven for thinking this wasn't a Lisa one, because you either remember Stupid Sexy Flanders or Leprosy. You don't remember this middle bit.
I think, one act of it is hers, right?
Yeah, if that.
Basically.
And even Marge kind of takes it over with her, like, relaxation stuff, which, yeah, cuts back to Marge. Not only, I've definitely been in Marge's situation when sick, not with a broken arm, but of just like, oh, I don't want to be a bother. I'll just clean this thing. I'll just do that.
I love that. Doesn't bother us.
It's just about getting more morphine. That's Marge, I think, gets addicted to morphine. For Marge to work at all in this middle section, she has to be doped up the entire time when she should be worrying about Lisa.
The B-star should be her morphine addiction.
And then, of course, we get Mr. Sakamoto.
We just had the news that I guess the black characters will no longer be voiced by white people, but I don't know if they're extending that to Asian characters yet.
I have a feeling.
I think they were saying every ethnicity.
Yeah, I think white actors won't
be
playing.
That'd be kind of weird. Yeah. That'd be pretty weird if they're like, okay, well, I guess with the black characters, just because there's a lot of black stuff in the news, but everybody else is still white.
I assume that was the move for whatever reason, but I guess it is every race is going to be played by.
I'm sure that's why it's happening, but it would be weird if you didn't just go like, okay, maybe let's not keep having this controversy and just make it all of them.
I can't imagine today in the writer's room, they say, all right, and Mr. Sakamoto, who should that be? Like,
Hank.
Well, Hank Azaria, of course. It should be. Yeah. And I'm not going to play any of him in this, but I do like that the character says the exact thing Disco Stu says, too. Like, he says, voila, I do my thing.
Okay. Yeah. He didn't really, I was wondering what his joke was outside of, like, dispensing pleasure, foot pleasure.
It seems to imply that Marge has never had a foot massage in her life before, either. Like, or a hair massage. As we see
that
after.
Is so funny. I love that guy.
They're working the hair a lot in this episode.
One of the hidden deleted scenes that you have to like access through the menu, Marge is getting her hair massage and the doctor finds a pacifier in there, but it's Bart's pacifier, so implying that for 10 years a pacifier has been stuck inside of her hair.
I believe it.
That would have been a good, I would have liked that joke. It's one of those ones you're like, oh, that would have been a funny joke in there. But yes, then we cut back to Lisa failing or more of her frustrations. And this taught me a bad lesson about washing dishes.
Mark, you were supposed to scour the pans.
They need to soak.
You said that 4 days ago. Look, they're rusted through.
It's an illusion.
No, it's not.
I got the groceries.
Good. Maple soda? A cell phone full of candy? Astronaut bread?
It's the bread of astronauts.
I didn't know Aerosmith made a cereal.
Dad, I gave you a list.
Oh, yeah. You were way up. Hello, Lollipop Island. There's a little girl here who had too many sour balls. Anyway, where were we? Hello? Hello? They hung up.
There are lots of callbacks in this episode. We see the grotesque Steven Tyler caricature that I love.
Yeah.
On that box of sweet emotions.
It's straight out of how he was drawn in Flaming Moe's when he's like singing Good Love, I think is it? Nah, whatever the song was. I don't know.
He's singing the give up.
If it's
Walk
if it's,
This Way?
If it's not Pink, I don't know.
Oh,
the song.
Pink is the song you know?
Or Love in the Elevator. I actually know lots of songs, but I can't remember which one it was.
You remember Mo singing Walk This Way, don't you?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, apparently there is maple soda now. It was a Shark Tank produced product. So
okay.
I don't know if it's in like larger markets, but Sap Seltzer is out there.
Hmm. Well, I feel like 15 years ago, me and my friends, we'd see at all the hipster places the funny sodas.
Oh, the like Jones sodas?
Like yeah, yeah.
Thanksgiving dinner soda and all that stuff.
Right. I think those sodas were very popularized. I don't remember a specific maple soda, but I think I'd rather drink a maple soda than a cream soda, but I'm definitely not a Hanson's cream soda. But
oh, man. two soda jokes, one episode.
So, again, this seems to show that Homer can't be trusted to buy groceries, but he can't be mean to Lisa and be like, oh, I didn't want to buy what you bought. It's just he buys everything that's in the impulse aisle, again, because he's a child. Like, especially the cell phone full of candy. Like, that is such a great buy me this mommy kind of purchase that Homer made. I love that. And yeah, Lisa, her reaction to the soaked through dishes too, like Bart's just an illusion.
Yeah.
Love that. And the Bart's using a racing form in that shot too. It's not commented on.
Yeah. That's a nice little gag.
I didn't even notice that.
After watching this episode before Bob came over, I was like, oh crap, I gotta wash my dishes. I can't let Bob see my... Because definitely in that previously mentioned roommate scenario, I was of the type of like, well, you know, it's going to be hard to scrub this macaroni and cheese stuff off of this pot.
Let it age in the sink.
Yeah, just soak it.
Mike and I are still regular soakers.
Yeah, I mean, I think there is truth to it.
There is merit. Yeah.
I don't know.
Soak.
I recently invested in nonstick cookware, like all across the board. I'm like, I was a fool to scrub anything ever. I was a fool.
I'm okay with an overnight soak. I just did that with my rice cooker pot. I did an overnight, but I try to not let it go more than a day.
A 4-day soak is probably a bit excessive.
Though I definitely have done it, and it did not rest through in my 20s. So. The Simpsons lied to me there. Oh, I also, sorry, one last one I want to shout out, like, astronaut bread. It's the bread of astronauts. Like, that's a great line.
Does what it says.
Then Lisa tries to call Marge for some help, but Marge is too high. I wonder, Lisa did get the place pretty cleaned up later, which after having 2 feet of water in the house is pretty crazy.
She must have called Surly Joe or something.
I love the Marco Polo game.
Then Homer, especially Homer's crash, and then he says, Polo.
Yeah, apparently when this happened to Mike Scully when he was a kid, he called his mom in the hospital when his older brother was chasing him with a knife.
Oh, God. Oh, man.
So it could have been a darker story.
That story did make me feel bad for memories I had a kid of, like, just not that kind of situation. But if me and my brother had an argument, you know, in our, like, when I was 10 and he was 7, let's say, we would call mom at work to be like, Mom, did this. And
we did that too. Yeah. Like, my sister would terrorize me and I would have to, like, call for help.
But... I just think now of all the stressful times I've had in an office job, and then imagining my kids calling me in between stuff with something else to be stressed about. I'm like, oh God, it's none of those like happy childless moments there. And I also like how Marge just hangs up on Lisa with like, I think so too. Bye. It's great animation on Snowball.
Her life has been so hard.
It's nice that Marge gets at least 2 weeks, 1 week, I guess, of being happy.
She's having a Rancho Relaxo experience here.
You're right. Actually, yeah. Pretty similar to that. Yeah.
No tequila, but morphine.
Also, that description of the bone could jam into her brain. I'm like, that's a horrifying description. I it's made me worry about like what people warn you about. I think anytime, Lindsay, has this ever happened to you when you've gone on a long flight and your mom has warned you, like, make sure to walk around, you'll get a blood clot,
oh, yeah,
and it'll give you a heart attack.
I worried about that all on my own.
Oh, okay.
My mom never said anything like that to me, but when I learned what a blood clot was, I have been afraid of them ever since. I have gone to the emergency room 3 times in my adult life because I was sure that I had a blood clot, but it was actually just a panic attack. Oh. About having a blood clot.
Oh, wow. Jeez. I'm sorry to bring up those memories.
Oh, it's fine. It's not an actually traumatic thing. It's just, you know, one of those hypochondriac for some reason. Because with birth control, blood clots, you get a higher risk for them.
Oh.
And as soon as I read that, I was like, oh, my God, I'm going to get a blood clot one day.
as people in the gaming industry, we were highest at risk for blood clots.
Oh, yes.
Constant sitting and flights to Japan.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, that's why I'd...
Did you get compression socks?
Oh, no.
Ooh, maybe I should invest in...
I bought some compression socks because I kept just having this total paranoia.
We've all taken those long California to Tokyo flights here, I think. That was when my mom warned me about it and put it in my head. I wasn't worried about it ever before, but I guess actually now 9 years ago when I did my first flight to Tokyo, that's when my mom was like, you got to get up and walk around every few hours. You got to do it.
She told me that about 30 times, and I appreciated it. It means she didn't want me to die.
Should.
Yeah, yeah. No, and
the moms are right. They almost always are.
And so Lisa is just about at the end of her rope, and... we get a very dark sequence with Lucy, the I Love Lucy show.
Yeah, yeah.
This is so strange.
This is so weird.
The weird alternate universe version of I Love Lucy where Ricky just beats her.
Yeah, yeah. The domestic violence jokes here, very dark. They feel 10 times darker now, but in the early 2000s, they were trying to keep up with South Park and Family Guy. It was a lot more normal to do a very mean-spirited joke like this.
I forgot that there was a callback to Ricky hitting Lucy later in the episode. And then they play the William Frawley impersonator at the end, Dan Castellaneta. I got to say, I believe on Podcast The Ride, they just talked about a Lucy thing recently.
The tribute to Lucy thing at Universal, yeah.
And on Gayest Episode Ever, they just did an episode about a gay joke on I Love Lucy. That's irrelevant to this conversation. What is relevant is the domestic abuse in that episode was Lucy thinks Ricky is going to kill her because she's crazy. You know, she's a zany housewife or whatever.
Right.
And Ricky's like, I don't know what I'm going to do. And William Frawley or what's his name again on the show?
Fred.
Thank
Fred
you.
Mertz is like, when Ethel gets in a mood, I always slip her a Mickey. So
whoa.
Drug your wife if she's, you know, acting up is basically the plot of the episode.
Wow.
And that is not called out as that's weird, that's messed up, Fred. But Ricky's like, no, I'll try that. So
try drugging my wife.
And then the joke after that is that Lucy thinks Ricky's trying to poison her, and really he's just trying to drug her.
Oh God.
Like every husband does.
That's all.
Yeah.
Wow.
So those
that's
kind of
cute.
50s values are all over I Love Lucy.
That's crazy, especially for a show that was made by one of the most powerful women in Hollywood at the time, that it still has that much entrenched sexism in it. I mean, that's just the 50s, I guess. But yeah, that okay. Well, so now the joke about spousal abuse less out of left field than in this clip. Were you a big Lucy watcher growing up yourself, Lindsay?
I didn't watch it a ton, but I watched it enough to where I'm very familiar with I Love Lucy, but it wasn't like I was watching it like The Simpsons.
I definitely caught a few in the Nick at Night nights I had as a kid.
Mm-hmm.
Though honestly, I was drawn more to the ones post-divorce because those were in color, the Lucille Ball shows.
That was a different show.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
That's when she was Carmichael. I hated those because...
But that had Mr. Mooney in it.
She was this Lucy by that point, which we hear in this episode.
Mike loves talking about old Lucy.
And I watched all of I Love Lucy probably three or four times through because the summer there was a three-hour block on a local station that was just I Love Lucy and Gomer Pyle and Andy Griffith and Happy Days. Just I watch all those all the way through in my youth, so I know all of this stuff.
Wow.
Except for Fred Mertz's name.
I wasn't familiar with the... Is it the Lucy show where she works in the bank?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
I wasn't familiar with that until I was an adult, but I would still laugh at Mystery Science Theater 3000 jokes where they would go, Mrs. Carmichael.
Oh, yes.
And I'm like, ha, 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 ha. But I didn't know what that was referencing until I was, 25.
That's right. Anytime on MST3K, if a slightly balding man with a mustache was on time, he would just go Lucy.
That's right. Yeah. And you'll love Oyster Lucy, remember?
Yeah.
I've just got to meet Bob Cummings.
Bev. And it's Tress McNeil doing the voice here, which is interesting too, because she does a great Lucille Ball.
Oh, yeah.
But also one of her earliest jobs in Hollywood, Tress McNeil, was doing the Lucy part of Weird Al Yankovic's 1983 song, Oh Ricky.
Not just the voice, but also playing her in the video.
Yes. Yeah.
Weird.
Weird Al, it was a different time, but he did play Ricky. He's a little tan, I'll say, in the clips there. But he wouldn't do that now.
No.
I'm just saying. But yes, why do
we... that video. That's if it's still playing anywhere.
It's at 2 million views on YouTube on the official Weird Al channel. I just gave it a watch today.
Oh, well then pull it from YouTube.
I'm not trying to get it Weird Al canceled. I'm sorry.
We hear you loud and clear. I will start that petition.
But yes, in this clip here, this is the time where I feel Homer is too mean to Lisa. Like, this is the too mean crossing for me.
Lucy? You hit her pretty hard there, Rick. Say, folks, what's all the ruckus?
Will you guys turn that thing down?
Sweetie, if we didn't turn it down for the cops, what chance do you have?
Jesus.
He hit her again.
Stupid English series, bunch of jerks, I can't believe it.
Losing your marbles, huh, kid?
Lucy?
Lucy McGillicuddy Ricardo Carmichael. And I think there's some more.
What are you doing here?
I came from heaven to help you get revenge on these bums. Is there an ashtray around here?
Will this do?
Thanks, doll. Now, we need a scheme to teach those slobs a lesson.
You mean like when you hid inside the conga drum to scare Ricky?
Hey, stay away from the drums. That's my bit. I got it. Here's what you do. Wait until they fall asleep. Then you sneak into their rooms and make sure they're fast asleep.
I mean, for as crazy as this plot twist is, that little whispering gag, it makes me die.
Make
sure they're safe.
It's so great because, you know, it should be peas and carrots. Peas and carrots are just the mumbling, but it's all audible. You hear what her plan is.
Yeah. So at this point in the series, in this point in the episode, literally Lucille Ball, her spirit invades the Simpsons home. Yes. To help Lisa solve her problem.
It's not a dream.
Yeah.
It's not. It is, as far as the show's reality is concerned, the real ghost of Lucy showed up to tell Lisa this plan. I think it's a meta commentary way. It feels like the show saying, okay, the next twist of Lisa trying to trick them into doing housework feels like an old school plot of a sitcom like I Love Lucy. So why not have Lucy show up to give her that idea? And then I think the third act is supposed to be like, well, here's how the Simpsons would make it way crazier than I Love Lucy would deal with this kind of caper.
It would involve electric needles.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Every also that Lucy is just smoking constantly. She had been gone for 11 years by the time this episode aired. I believe she'd passed in 1989, mm-hmm. And that she's still smoking up in heaven too. But I guess it can't do any more damage in heaven. So,
well, it's heaven. You can't do whatever you want in heaven.
That's true. Yeah. And I also like how she's such a professional. She's like, hey, that's my bit. Like, she's very, very defensive. Apparently,
you're right. I didn't think it felt extra mean when Homer made that joke about the cops. Mm-hmm. But when it's immediately followed by a smack and Homer laughing and saying he hit her again, it does feel a little bit meaner.
Yes. Yeah.
Just because it's followed up by that.
I think if Homer didn't say sweetie before that, it would come off even worse, I guess. But just his way. I mean, Homer is the jerk in a bad neighbors like horror film of like, we didn't stop for the cops. We're not stopping for you. The plot is that Lisa will paint on them with poster paint and oats to make them think they have gangrene kind of lesions all over themselves. And there's some great, more crazy drawings in this, like the sleeping Bart drawing where he has kind of like a crocodile, his classic crocodile mouth. I love that. And also the way they look in the mirror is pretty good.
Yeah, like
too.
Rushing towards the camera and like pulling at their skin. Really cool.
And I love how Lisa says, like, I don't like the look of this. You don't? Because that's what I said. Like, tell her that part. That's a great line. And then we get some WebMD jokes, which I just have stopped going to WebMD. If I ever have a fear, I'm just like, oh, what does this feeling mean? WebMD always takes me to something that sounds very terminal. I'm like, well, now I just feel worried. Like, I now I'm a no WebMD guy.
I guess
I don't enter symptoms anymore. I'll just go and look at it as a reference for something I do definitely know that I have or somebody else has, or just looking it up for my own knowledge.
Yeah, I wasn't sure if it was too early for WebMD, but apparently 98 was the year of WebMD.
Pretty new, but here
their version of WebMD is pretty funny, though.
Yeah. Well, I guess especially in a pre-HD television era, or early, I guess maybe you'd say early HD, you can't really have them scroll through a web page on screen anyway. Like, the text wouldn't read and it's kind of boring. So in making it a virtual cartoon doctor that talks is a smart way of fixing it. Yeah, yeah. And though as a video gamer, I have always been confused by their reference to real video game Dragon Quest.
I think that's just to them. It was like, this sounds like a game. I think they had no idea what Dragon Quest was because it wasn't even Dragon Quest in America yet.
Yeah, yeah. If you were somebody who played those games in English, you knew them as Dragon Warrior, if you even played them. And I mean, Dragon Quest to English speakers, I think, always has sounded... I love the game series, but it's kind of a generic sounding name for a fantasy role-playing game, right? So I can just see that the writers are like, Dragon Quest. Yeah, that's a video game.
Yeah, it does sound...
You wouldn't think it's a real thing just the way they say it in this, but yes, the virtual doctor in this next clip is played by Elwood Edwards. Mm-hmm. The voice of You've Got Mail,
yes.
Goodbye, all those things.
I want to, if you
I did
look
not
those
catch that.
Oh yeah, I think it's because he's recorded at too high of a quality on this because it's for broadcast that the joke is lost. Like, he recorded those AOL sounds on a tape recorder in his living room, and
right.
Then those sounds were compressed to be spat out to your computer at like 14 kilobytes per second. That's why.
Great.
He doesn't sound like the AOL guy. I don't know. After you play the clip of him, can you play like the actual, like, You've Got Mail?
Sure, sure.
What's wrong with us?
Oh, I don't like the looks of this.
You don't? Because that's what I said. Tell her, Bert.
Shut up. Shut up. We better check with the doctor.
Welcome to Virtual Doctor. From the makers of Dragon Quest and Sim Sandwich. Enter symptoms now.
Let's see. Crusty sores?
Yes.
Horrible wailing?
Yes! Yes!
Any exposure to unsanitary conditions?
Duh! We're pigs!
Okay, and diagnose.
You've got leprosy.
Leprosy!
Ah! Unclean!
Unclean!
Unclean! Help us, virtual doc! Look at me! I'm on my knees!
Goodbye.
Excellent.
Yep, they got goodbye in there too.
Yeah. Okay, here's...
I knew that they were referencing that. I just couldn't tell it was the guy.
They actually went to the trouble of finding him. Well, here is the original You've Got Mail.
You've Got Mail.
That is so
You've
crunchy.
You've Got Mail.
Yes. Yeah.
I love it.
Man, I remember when getting a mail was like a thing to be celebrated. A man would tell you. He would announce it proudly throughout the house that you have mail.
Be so annoying if it happened now.
But did you guys see the viral content from 2016 of it's two people, they get an Uber driver and they're like, oh, our Uber driver is the You've Got Mail guy.
I think I read that he was like later found to be an Uber driver.
Yes. Yeah. He's
Man.
Well, in the video, he's happy to share it. He's like, oh, like the person goes, guess who's driving me in this Uber? You've Got Mail. Like, he just does it off the top of his head.
We just talked about how...
Oh, I'm just bummed that he had to be an Uber driver.
Me too.
Yeah.
I mean, we just talked about how AOL bought something for $178 billion.
Yep. Yeah.
They couldn't get this guy set for life.
Give him $1 million.
Yeah,
just
yeah.
Just give him one mil. Like, yeah, it's...
Yeah.
it's kind of it's a bit wrong. You're right. Yeah. But hey, at least I hope the Simpsons at least paid him pretty good for showing up here for this.
I'm sure he still gets residuals from
this. Yeah, sure, I bet he got SAG scale.
I bet he gets more residuals for this than he does for AOL discs playing.
I would hope so.
And also, yeah, Lisa just straight up does Mr. Burns is excellent here. And then we come to the third act, which is just like wacky town.
In about it's, 3 minutes.
Yeah. So it starts with, you know, I think a normal sitcom would have, like, say, Full House would have done trick the characters into doing housework. They then realize.
Yeah, I was very surprised by that. By the fact that that does not happen. It completely backfires.
Even though they are fully believing it, they are still like, no, I can't clean. Even at this point, like, I literally will not touch a mop.
Well, Full House is not going to build another set for the characters to leave and go to, so yeah. They'd just be stuck inside.
Well, they could do a Full House episode where it's like, and then they go to Disney World to fix their leprosy. They decide instead to head off to a leper island. First they just ask for help from God, which, you know, in a few episodes, Homer is going to think that Christ's name is Jeebus, but here he knows it's Jesus. So, man, there's some continuity there.
Simpsons.
He is getting stupider.
That is a big slip up.
I
love Bart's joke.
Oh, the why would God punish a kid? I mean, an American kid.
Yes, it's great.
I love that joke. It's a great commentary on how, like, I don't know, a Christian
Americans thing. Feel about themselves.
Oh, yes. Yeah. That that if you're an American Christian, you're like, well, if I'm happy, it's because God is nice to me. And you're like, well, then why is there suffering in other countries? Oh, it must be that God favors Americans.
They did something wrong, clearly.
And so they head across the street to Flanders. This is another just great. They become zombies in this next clip very briefly.
Brains! Brains! Use your brains to help us. Your delicious brains.
Oh, those poor souls. What's the Christian thing to do?
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Thank you, you wonderful man.
All right, food.
Bart, leave some for Rod and Todd. Here you go, lad.
Todd, no!
Listen, Homer, we'd love to help you, but we're not really set up for lepers.
So you're shunning us?
No. I'm just thinking we could send you to a better place. You know, a place where they could really take care of you.
Oh, thank you, good sir.
Ooh, that smarts. Boys, get the alcohol-free alcohol.
That, I gotta say, all this face mask and quarantining stuff hits a little different now.
That's true, yeah.
You really, now that we're in quarantine, you didn't realize how many TV shows and movies had a plague plot line.
Yes, yeah.
Although, you watch anything now and it's like, oh, it's a freaking pandemic plot line.
It was fantasy then. It was a fun idea.
Yeah, like, ah, ha, 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 wouldn't it be funny if we gave them an infectious disease?
How silly it would be to take precautions about exposure to something.
I just know I'm going to be openly protesting the first Zoom-based sitcom.
Oh, God.
It's no longer going to be a one-off special. It's going to be like, this is the Zoom show. We're all zooming around.
Actually. I want every TV show and movie to take place in an alternate universe where COVID does not exist, because I don't want to see all of these stay-at-home media that's going to pop up now. I don't want it.
We're in for trouble. Like, I totally agree with you, because I don't want to see any, like, well, here's our cute COVID love story or the COVID office or whatever. Like, no, I want escapism. Yeah. I don't want to look at this.
Yeah, be outside.
Absolutely. Yeah. And you know, with the safety concerns of even filming live action together again, I think it's time to, you know, more animation than ever needs to be greenlit by production companies, starting with the third season of Infinity Train.
I agree wholeheartedly.
And the writers need to be made WGA.
Absolutely, for sure. Yes. Yeah. That sucks. I'm sorry.
The Animation Guild means well.
Hmm. Yeah, no, I've heard...
It just doesn't have a lot of members to get the leverage that it needs.
Well, you know, you're in company there with early Simpsons, right? It wasn't until season 10 that Simpsons became even a WGA show.
Was it 10? I thought it was 7 at least.
No,
it was 10.
Yeah.
Jeez.
Yeah, 99, I think, right, Henry?
Yeah, you know, Mike Scully, one of the best things he did in his time on the show was he spearheaded the push to make them full WGA. We interviewed him about this, and it was right when Family Guy was launching that and Futurama, that he's like, okay, the three of us together, we can get this show going, or we can get this WGA thing going with Fox. And, you know, to Seth MacFarlane's credit, like, and he was a new showrunner, like a new TV show creator. He joined in with Scully. Like, he's like, yeah, let's do it. We'll make this WGA. Like, so it's an inspiring story of how, and, but took him 10 years to get that show to be WGA.
Yeah, it took him 10 years to get the name power. So depressing.
In happier news, yes. Leprosy. Let's talk about Leprosy.
Yeah,
I did some
leprosy
research, and apparently it is not very contagious. You need like prolonged exposure to like the droplets, so it's even less contagious than, let's say, COVID-19.
So
the leper colonies were just people not understanding the disease, and that's why those things happened.
I know it, that's why it would largely spread between families.
And I saw too that it wasn't like, it's been pretty, not preventable, but curable for the last like 50 years too. And also why it's called Hansen's is because Hansen is the name of the scientist who discovered the actual, like, you know, virus that causes leprosy as well. So that, you know, if leprosy is such a good, not good, I mean, it's a memorable,
it's
yeah, the word is a memorable word and works because of the stigma attached to it. I can see why saying Hansen's disease didn't really like catch on, you know.
But it's also good for somebody with Hansen's disease. So if somebody like asks, they're like, oh, I have Hansen's disease. And they're like, okay, I don't know what that is. Oh, I'm so sorry. Whereas if you're like, I have leprosy, that person's going to have a completely different reaction.
Yes. Yeah. And Homer kisses Ned right on the mouth too. And he loses his mustache from that.
You can't kiss strangers anymore. Or your neighbors.
No more kissing neighbors. It sucks.
Tragic. That's the biggest loss, I think.
Also, we just finished doing season one, so seeing a Jell-O mold joke is again a very season one kind of Simpsons thing.
The horror of the family is great.
Yes.
And just, I really laughed at Homer scooping the Jell-O with his hand and saying, eat up.
He wants a rod to eat out of his hand.
It is funny, though, because it's unclear why they flee to the Flanders house.
Because
they had a whole perfectly good house.
They are looking for somebody as good as Jesus to help them with their leprosy. So,
oh, right.
Also worth noting that this other than her final episode as a living character, this is the last appearance of Maude in a speaking role before her passing. So enjoy it. Enjoy these Maude lines here.
She did not sound like herself, did she?
No. She's been replaced for this season. That's
okay.
That's one of the unfortunate angles of why they chose to kill off Maude.
Yeah.
Is that there was drama with the actress who had played her for the previous 10 years on the show, wanting a, you know, basically a standard of living increase, like not even a huge raise. And and they felt that they wouldn't pay that.
That sucks.
Yeah, unfortunately, Maude did not live to see the Ben-Hur remake.
Oh, yes.
So,
How many times are they going to remake that thing? I don't understand
that.
They
need to kill more horses.
But I do like they bring into the Ned and Maude relationship the thing that, you know, them saying, like, you watched that without me? Like, that but with a Christian film is funny.
I love the imagination Christmas joke.
Oh, yes. Yeah, they're
so excited.
I want to see that gif on a loop of them just like walking, moving back and forth. We cut back to the house. Lisa gets an awkward phone call from Mo where they find out that Mo has been kind of cheating on Homer with them. He's especially like, oh, Wow. Okay. And that idea of an eye-opener drink, like, that definitely feels like it's a drink from when it was more normal to drink in the morning.
It's like a Mad Men era terminology. Like, yeah. I need an eye-opener. Yes. Just in disbelief that Lisa would think Homer was going to the gym in the morning. I did like that.
And if you want to make your own eye-opener out there, I've got the recipe from Esquire's website.
Oh.
So you want 1 1/2 ounces of dark rum, 1/2 teaspoon of orange curacao, 1/2 teaspoon of apricot liqueur, 1 teaspoon of grenadine, and 1 egg yolk. And that is how you get an eye opener.
I don't drink before 10 a.m., unfortunately. So
no, I mean, this. If you're somebody who needs an eye-opener, Homer getting an eye-opener each morning at the bar says a lot about Homer and his rampant alcoholism, I think.
I'm the opposite. I don't drink anytime after 10 a.m.
Oh, get it all in the morning, right? You can work it off.
Yeah. I do about 3 cups of eye openers, and then I can't have any later in the day because then I won't fall asleep.
You could just pour vodka into your pancake batter. It's fine.
Mm. Yeah.
That, instead of milk, I'm going to give that a shot.
Yeah, it's a real one-to-one swap out.
Lisa hangs up on Mo, despite Mo demanding he not hang up on her. And Marjorie enters the house, and she's walking on a cane, but just for this scene, she has lost the cane by the time she appears in Hawaii in the next bit. This is when they find out that they sent them to Molokai Island, which had been referenced on the show before.
All right, right.
It was in Mr. Plow. Mr. Plow opens with Circus of the Stars from Molokai Island, not just for lepers anymore.
And we heard about the good islands, not the leper ones.
Yeah, one too.
Apparently, mandatory isolation ended in Molokai in 1969.
Wow, so 50, it was like 30 years ago when this episode of Simpsons aired. Yeah, I think finally Hawaii is no longer associated with leprosy.
This is the first I'm hearing of this that it ever was.
I mean, when I was like 12 and seeing jokes on The Simpsons about leper islands, they made no sense to me, but I just...
Yeah,
that was,
I think,
like,
I just accepted them without thinking any further past it. Leper colony is something I had heard before, but leper island was not something I had.
I think they'd usually be islands just to separate them from the rest of, like, non-leprous people.
Mm-mm. I've also never been to Hawaii. Still have not. In my gaming press days, I was definitely jealous of like 3 guys who I got to go on business trips to Hawaii because they had to play a video game in Hawaii.
I was just thinking, like, last spring we almost went to Hawaii, me and my fiance, and we're like, you know what? That's kind of impulsive. We'll just go later. There will never be a later.
Oh God!
They'll never let me go.
Lindsay, have you dreamed of going to Hawaii, or have you been?
I have dreamed. I have not been. My mom lived there for about a year, but
wow.
I have not been. Yeah. Also, I was not born when she was there for a year, so I don't know why that was exactly relevant. But
your mom was bragging to you about Hawaii all your youth?
Yes. She's like, when I lived on Hawaii, it was so cheap. Also, the bugs were huge.
Wow. Yeah, for all of the Hawaii talk, they are there for 90 seconds of this episode. I think I have like 5 notes about Hawaii.
Yeah.
It barely happened.
I measured it in the thing. I was like, it's literally 90 seconds. And that's if you count Homer singing a song over the credits.
Yeah. I don't know if I said this on the show or just before the show, but like, I think they're in the Flanders house longer than Hawaii.
Yes, you are right. They head over to Hawaii. We cut to Bart and Homer being dropped off by a taxi driver who refused to take their money. That's a funny drawing. And if you're going to Hawaii in the late 90s, you have to make a gay marriage joke. It is the law of comedy then.
Yeah.
Homer says, we're going to watch a couple gay guys get married, which the history on that now, of course, you know, with marriage equality being the rule all across the U.S., these jokes are kind of lost to time, but Hawaii was one of the leading states of the battle over marriage equality. In 1991, a lawsuit from three same-sex couples was brought against the state government in Hawaii, them wanting to be given a marriage license and being refused it. In 1996, a judge ruled that the state couldn't ban same-sex couples from getting a marriage license, but then by 1999, they ratified an amendment to their the state constitution that made same-sex marriage illegal again. Though at the time they well, though at the time Hawaii did have a version of civil unions that was better than any other state in the U.S. if you know, so I don't, not that that's, you know, cool. Great. Yeah. And then, you know, 2013.
This is too late in the game, guys. Too late in the game to be that bigoted.
And in 2013, they made the state of Hawaii made it legal. They were not the first state in the U.S. to do it, but 2 years ahead of the Supreme Court ruling that legalized it. When we just, at the time of recording, we just passed the anniversary of it.
Okay.
And it was 5 years. I'm like, man, that 5 years flew right by. Like, yeah.
I completely forgot about
that. 5 years happened 50 years ago.
I forgot about that because, like, what I associate Hawaii the most with now, or at least 10 years ago. So if they made this episode 5 years later, it would be about Dog the Bounty Hunter.
Yes.
It's like, yeah. That was the pop culture reference. No longer gay marriage. It was this guy, this roadie looking guy, who was racist.
Joe Tiger.
Joe Exotic, the Tiger King.
Yeah. I watched that. You can tell by the way I called it Joe Tiger.
I think he was in Oklahoma, or if it was Oklahoma and
they're
Florida.
All over the place. Yeah.
I don't think they let him into Hawaii.
So we get to hear about the electric needle room.
Whoa, this is a hospital?
That it is. We'll take the cure, bag a few lobsters, then watch some gay guys get married.
Ah, you must be the Simpsons.
Howdy, and thanks for not recoiling in horror.
Thank you for the friendly howdy.
Can we get a room with a view?
Oh, you'll have a great view of the whole beach from the electric needle room.
Really? The whole beach?
Yes, from the electric needle room.
Electric needle room?
I love that it takes him hearing that twice to react to it.
I kind of wanted one more beat of Homer not getting it, but there's not enough time.
I do like that on the second time he says it, there's still like a very long pause between him saying it again and Homer realizing.
Their engagement with the electric needles for the other minute of this episode is so funny that they both love it and hate it. And like the shot of Bart hearing Homer screaming and going like, that's not my turn.
And he's next.
Yes. Yeah.
Like, he looks at his number two.
I think the doctor is more interested in getting paid. He should know up front, like, this is paint and oatmeal. Like,
yes, yeah.
I was thinking that. I was like, surely the experts can tell the difference.
Homer would need to eat one of his sores to know it, which that joke made me gag.
Yeah.
That was pretty disgusting. But also, they just all seem to be accepting, like, well, you don't have leprosy, but we also want to treat you. I mean, maybe it's the Flanders already paid for it. So they're like, all right, we'll do it. Yeah, the many jokes, the multiple jokes of just their bloody backs and the bloody bandages.
Yeah, covered in gauze.
Oh,
yeah.
Horrifying.
It's real gross.
Yeah. And from what I read on treatment of it, you don't use electric needles on treating Hansen's disease. Like, it is more about like antibiotics and antiviral treatments, that kind of skin needle stuff. That's more for like old school wart removal and stuff. That's what I think of with electric needle jokes.
I think like acne.
Well, that doesn't make for a fun pain joke.
That's true. If Homer and Bart were just popping pills and be like, oh, this isn't so bad.
It should have involved more acid, I think. Is acid funnier than needles? Vote in the comments.
Boy, that's tough.
Or they take the antibiotics, but because they don't really need them, it just kills off healthy bacteria and they get C. diff.
Oh, yeah, I like that. That's a good pitch.
Alternate pitch.
I like that. but yes, the family is reunited. How much money did Lisa Marge spend, or did Marge, I guess, spend to fly them to Hawaii? Because
ski trips, flights to Hawaii. What's going on with his family?
90s money? Yeah, maybe like 1,000.
Well, and Marge just had a long stay at a hospital, which, I mean, you know, insurance only goes so far. And how good is the health insurance at the power plant anyway?
God, it was
also, they sent her to Springfield Presbyterian, not cheapo St. Mary's.
Yeah.
Yeah, we were in the economic surplus, though, so.
That's true. Yeah, actually, that AOL Time Warner deal is happening because the dot-com bubble is at the biggest it ever will be in the year 2000. It was, boy, what a happy 18 months we were going to have in January 2000. We didn't know it. But yes, here's one last clip as the family is happily reunited in Hawaii.
Time to turn over.
Here they are.
Oh, thank God you're all right.
Dad, Bart, I played a horrible trick on you and I'm really sorry. You don't have leprosy. It's just oatmeal.
Yeah, we know.
I figured it out after I ate one of my chest swords.
Well, then let's get out of here.
No way. We scored a free Hawaiian vacation.
This place is a blast. All we have to do is endure 2 hours of blinding pain. Then it's nothing but shopping and surfing.
Tonight we're going to put our fake swords back on, then jump the fence at Club Med and scare the normals.
Well, it all sounds lovely, but...
Come on, listen up. This is paradise.
And then Homer screams a bit over the credits, which I won't make the listeners hear that.
Sings the classic Aloha Oi.
Yeah. You know, this just hit me here, and we've talked about this before in Lisa episodes, where they make her apologize for a thing she shouldn't apologize for.
Oh, like, yeah. I guess I lost the plot completely.
Yeah.
I mean, she did make them think they have leprosy, which I think is like maybe an overreaction to keeping a dirty house.
I guess that's true, but shouldn't they at least apologize back to her of like, hey, we're sorry we were so messy and didn't help you
they
with
absolutely
it.
Yeah. Should, yes.
I will say, to be fair, Lisa was tricked by an evil ghost.
That's true, yeah. She should yeah. say, I never should have listened to Lucille Ball.
The evil ghost of Lucille Ball.
Yeah, I guess, I mean, it's just in the Make Room for Lisa episode last season, in season 10, it's all this one-sided apologizing that Lisa does. Like, she goes like, oh, I'm sorry, it's just this. It's like, I don't know, no character apologizes to Lisa for treating her like dirt, so it just feels imbalanced to me, you know.
Yep. What are you gonna do?
And Marge, clearly Hawaii is treating Marge very well because she's just like dumped her cane. She isn't even walking around.
It's that hot weather. All the bones are just knitting together.
Well, she got up and walked a bit on the plane. The plane trip over.
It works.
That's be a long flight from Springfield to Hawaii.
Yeah. Taking a quick walk on planes helps prevent blood clots and heal broken bones.
It sets a compound fracture easily. Like that also, I forgot to mention too, when they remove her cast, that feels like a real writer's room full of men joke about how a woman has hairy legs after a week.
Yeah, but there's nothing funny about it. It's like, yeah, your hair would grow under a cast, and
but instead
or maybe it is a sign that it was written by a woman because a guy would be like, oh yeah, I never thought of that.
No, that's true. Yeah.
Could go either way.
Though Hibbert's disgust at it is like
that is, yeah.
A little unfair to Marge. Like, yeah, she didn't shave her leg under a cast. Like, give her a break.
He's done surgeries before. Leg hair is grossing him out.
And he's fully got a mouthful of canker sores. Who's he to judge, you know? But yeah, that's that episode is all over the place. It is a crazy, wacky episode, but there's a lot of funny stuff in it, and I can't think too badly of an episode that gave us Stupid Sexy Flanders.
Yep.
Well, Lindsay, any final thoughts yourself?
No, I was pleased. I don't think that I've seen this episode before, but I do have a just god-awful memory. So it is possible I had, but I very much enjoyed myself because I did stop watching after I went to college, which was in 2000. So maybe I had seen this, but
yeah, I only...
it's fun to watch a later episode.
Every act is a different episode of this episode, and I only remembered the second act. Like, oh yeah, Lisa is the mom, and the and Bart and Homer are bad. I forgot about skiing, and I forgot about Hawaii. So
yeah, it's as if they could all be separate episodes.
Yes, it's a real grab bag, and I think they eventually went back to Hawaii at some point.
I think for a real,
I'd
Simpsons.
Be shocked if they did.
What state haven't they gone to? They've been to Delaware, so they got to go back to Hawaii.
But Lindsay, thank you so much again for doing the show.
Thank you so much for having me.
And do you have any final plugs you want to give?
Yeah, please check out Infinity Train streaming on HBO Max. Books 1 and 2 are already up there, and book 3 should be coming out soon by the time this episode comes out. Yeah, we're very excited about it, and we hope that everybody likes it a lot.
And Teen Creeps, your podcast is a lot of fun.
Oh, right. Yeah, I also have a podcast. Yeah, please check out Teen Creeps. We read YA horror from the 80s and 90s, like Christopher Pike, R.L. Stine, Lois Duncan, all those like teen slasher books with the cool covers.
Awesome.
And I host that with Kelly Nugent, who is great.
That's awesome. Thank you. Thank you so much for coming on. We got to have
you
back.
Thank you.
That was so much fun.
Yeah, it was a pleasure. Thanks, guys.
So thanks again to Lindsay for being on the show. Be sure to check out all of her stuff. But as for us, if you want to check out more of our stuff and get all these episodes 1 week ahead of time and ad-free, please go to patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. Sign up there for $5. You'll get just that, but also access to everything behind the $5 paywall. When you sign up, you'll immediately get access to all the stuff we made for the past more than 3 years at this point. That's a lot of podcasts, over 100 bonus podcasts, which includes all of our limited miniseries, the most recent of which was Talking Mission Hill. We did the entire Mission Hill only season using the Talking Simpsons / What a Cartoon treatment, and it's all there on the Patreon behind that paywall, along with all of our other miniseries, interviews, and so much more. And Henry can tell everybody out there what's happening at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons at the $10 level. One mega long podcast once a month that is only for patrons of that level or higher.
That's right. If you enjoy me and Bob breaking down Simpsons episodes or animated series, you'll want to hear us do it for a different animated feature film once a month on the What a Cartoon Movie podcast. Like with What a Cartoon, we take film and do the history of it and a scene-by-scene breakdown of it, often for over 4 hours. If you sign up now, you can hear recent ones like The Black Cauldron and Space Jam and an entire back catalog, over 80 hours of What a Cartoon Movie podcast for you to enjoy. If you sign up at the $10 level or up your $5 pledge to $10, and you get all that $5 stuff as well at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons.
So as for me, I have been one of your hosts, Bob Mackey. You can find me on Twitter as Bob Servo, and my other podcast is Retronauts. It's a classic gaming podcast about old video games. Find it wherever you find podcasts, or go to patreon.com/retronauts. Sign up there for 2 exclusive episodes every month. Again, that is patreon.com/retronauts. Henry, what about you?
Follow me on Twitter at @HENEREYG. You'll get all your Henry Gilbert updates there, and I tweet a bunch of fun things. Also, if you enjoy this podcast and its sister podcast, What a Cartoon, and want to stay informed whenever new stuff happens on them, please follow @TalkSimpsonsPod on Twitter. @TalkSimpsonsPod tweets out whenever there are new episodes on the free feeds or on the Patreon, or when we have cool new miniseries and other stuff coming up. So please stay in the loop by following @TalkSimpsonsPod on Twitter.
Thanks so much for listening, folks. We'll see you next time for Faith Off, and we'll see you then.
Everything myself.
Hey, is Homer there?
No, he isn't. I don't know where he is.
I'm a little worried. He usually stops in for an eye opener on the way to work.
He told us he'd been going to the gym.
Wow. Anyway, you don't think he could be at another bar, do you? Because I couldn't take that. I just couldn't. I don't hang up on me.
92% of households that start the year with Peloton are still active a year later.
All because of a fancy bike?
It's not just a bike. Peloton makes treadmills too.
Eh, all treadmills are the same.
Our treadmills can adjust speed and incline automatically, so you never break your stride. Whether you're squeezing in a power walk or training for a marathon, Peloton can help you achieve your fitness goals. 92% stick with it. So can you. Try the Peloton Tread risk-free with a 30-day home trial. New members only. Not available in remote locations. See additional terms at onepeloton.com/home-trial.